Introducing your host for this evening, for Access Awareness Virtual Scratch Night, it's Ellen Lilly! In 40 minutes of content done. Boom. Hello, welcome, good morning, good evening. We're live, are we? I don't know. Are you alive? Are we all alive? Yes, it's virtual scratch night, baby. What is going on? What day is it? Who am I? where am I? Well, I'll tell you, I'm in Newcastle because I'm back home living with my mum. I'm also half-arsed Ellen right now. Everything's half-arsed. I'm everything half-arsed at the moment. Look, I'm just going to put my foot up on my bed because I can, because I'm half-arsed. How are we all? Oh, we're surviving. We're nearly there, you know. Honestly, I know it feels like a lifetime, but we are. We're nearly there. There's light at the end of the tunnel. These type of virtual things will end eventually, and we'll get proper things happening, because I am sick of them. I'm sick. I'm sorry, but I am. I'm sick of all this virtual crap. But we've got to do it because there's nothing else we can do. So we've got to love it at the same time. But it's going to be great. It is going to be great. Yeah, because we've got some amazing stuff for you tonight. Because what else have you got to do? Yeah, you've got absolutely nothing else to do. Apart from watch us and watch all the amazing things we've got, some fantastic plays, and you're seeing it first, sat at the comfort in your own home, and it's free. So who's winning? Everyone. But yes, I think lockdown has made us evaluate your entire life. I think lockdown has just made us absolutely evaluate everything. And I think, if anything, it's really confirmed I am a genuinely lazy person. And I just need to accept that. And the faster I accept that, the faster I can just get on with normal life when we get back to it. Because I'm the type of person that will say, like, well, yeah, I could be like that if I had all the time. You know, I could look like J-Lo if I had the time. You know, I could cook like Ramsay if I had the time, but I've got the time and I've done nowt. So it's confirmed I'm lazy, and that is fine. That brilliant. But I do. I hope you're well. I'm lazy. Anyone else sick of quizzes? I am. Best thing about lockdown though, well, I'm living back at home. Obviously, you might not know me, so I normally live in London. I normally live in London. I moved there to become an actor, and that is going so well. I work full time at a call centre normally, but I couldn't survive there. I couldn't live, so I had to come back and live with my mum. That's nice, isn't it? That's great. No, but it is. We have been getting on really well. I normally do a joke about the fact that my mum doesn't know a lot of the food that I eat when I come back up here. You know, like avocado, like, you know, like the posh stuff that you get in London. But we reached a new level the other day, because my mum asked before she went to the shop, what do you want for breakfast? And I says, granola. I think that's standard breakfast request. And she asked what aisle that would be in. Where would you get granola? So yeah, challenging times. But we got it in the end. And she's eating it. So there we go. Also, I've refound the absolute love of winding up my mum. I love it. That is what I miss the most, not living at home, is pissing my mum off. It's like a hobby, and it's probably got us through the lockdown. My favourite thing at the moment is no matter what time of day, she might be in another room, I'll be in the living room, and all I do is beep, and she's alone. Now this, I mean, we're on week what, 6, 7? I've been beeping for 7 weeks. I've now got it to the point where she thinks it's the batteries in the alarm, the fire alarm. Success. That is pure delight and entertainment. So if anyone else is struggling, just give it a go. And see what I mean. She thought, at one point she thought it was the Wi-Fi box because the Wi-Fi has been down. But now we're onto the fire alarm. So that's great. Let's see if we can wind her up now for the lols, because I've got no content, nothing to say. Let's try. Mum! Stinks! Let's see if she comes in. Mum!
What? Stinks? Fuck off.
Gold. Absolute gold.
What you doing?
Right, you can go now. That's all I need. Bye. Right, it's time to crack on. Let's get to your first... I was gonna say quiz. Let's get to the first act of the evening. Okay, so let's crack on with some of the performances for this evening. Up next, we have Never Have I Ever by Lizzie Jackson. Amelia is the only one who has been drinking the Captain Morgans during the classic drinking game, Never Have I Ever. Classic. By this point, everyone knows the ins and outs of her sexual life, her sins, and her most disgusting experiences. So fuck it. Why not just let it all loose? Ooh. Performed by Mia Curley. Enjoy.
Okay. Never have I ever drank piss. Okay, I'll give you an easier one. It was an accident, by the way, guys. It was dark. Thought it was water. Bit of advice, ladies. Never share a tent with a boy. All right. Never have I ever caught chlamydia. Done anal. Okay, I'll give you an even easier one. Never have I ever... given a hand job on the beach. Foot job? Just in general. It's male and female, by the way, guys. It's all welcome. No? Not even a cheeky hand job on the beach. Fucking hell. None of you. You've never done any of those things. I can't tell whether I'm impressed. Oh, seriously, seriously disappointed in each and every one of you. They'd all stare at me like that. I know I'm a slut, okay? But I'm proud. You should be too, of yourselves, of your inner slut. I mean, come on. Some of you must be lying. Everybody loves a good old rogering sometimes. We're just too afraid to say it. Come on, let's say it. I love a good old rogering. Okay, see how it is. You're just not ready to embrace the power of a truly good old rogering. Female sexuality, guys. Come on. The fact that none of you have not had one single chlamydia scare is really quite upsetting. And I don't know you all that well, but it makes me genuinely sad. Since I pretty much drank the entirety of this bottle since the beginning of the game, I'm going to dedicate this to you, my darling virgins, or suppressed insecure feminine souls, release yourself. Become like me. No, that did sound a bit narcissistic, didn't it? But become like me. Become like you. Do you want some? I've never mastered willpower. Just yesterday, I ate 3 entire jars of pickles and threw up everywhere. It was a bad choice. I wouldn't recommend it. But the thing is with me, if you tell me I can't do something, I'm just going to fucking do it. Not that anyone told me I couldn't eat 3 jars of pickles. That was entirely self-inflicted. But there's this game, this life game that we all play. Well, some of us clearly don't know how to play. You know, some people are happy to just settle down and have that plain vanilla ice cream. But most of us, I reckon, we want it to be dangerous. Come on. You know you do. We've all felt it. That little tingly feeling in the bottom of your spine, that little nudge, that go on, that what if, and boom. And all of a sudden, you've gone through in the most disgusting amount of detail about what your life would be like together, what you'd be arguing about in 5 years' time, what your dog would be called, what she, what they would feel like down there, and your head's full of naughty things. And if you're a good person, you have that really annoying pit of your stomach guilt feeling, all wrapped up with the overwhelming desire just to have a motherfucking good old rogering. It's all about the what if, ladies. That's what gets you. And I admire you all. Well, those of you that aren't lying, for resisting it. I mean, you can have this argument with yourself about wanting to eat chocolate cake or wanting to fuck your best friend. Oh, oops. That was meant to be a secret. Not the chocolate cake bit. Obviously, everybody wants to eat cake. Fuck. I want to fuck my best friend. That feels weird saying that out loud. I wish it wasn't true. No, I don't wish it wasn't true. I just wish it wasn't wrong. Maybe it isn't wrong. Maybe I'm a polyamorous goddess and you and your fucking judgment is wrong. Just joking. Am I? Who knows? The really annoying thing, though, is that I can tell she fancies me too. She looks at me with these eyes, especially when she's high. And I know everybody looks at people with those eyes and wants to kiss everyone when they're high, but it's different with us. We have conversations with our eyes. She pulls me away from the crowd, and we don't even know where our boyfriend is. We don't even know where our friends are. It's just us dancing. The world is history. And then she looks down at my lips, and I can tell that she really wants to kiss me, and it is so fucking hard to resist all night long. I am exhausted for weeks after that. She does it when she's drunk too. Never sober though. Fuck being sober though, what is that? Don't get me wrong. I do love my boyfriend. He's amazing. He's good in bed. My best friend and all that. Maybe that's why I feel so guilty. But it is that, it's that kind of guilt feeling that feels good. You've made me feel really fucking weird now. I'm not that much of a slut, am I? Oh God, I'm a fucking weirdo, aren't I? We were good together. The Would that ruin us? Would we exchange 3 months of ecstasy for our precious, precious friendship? Or maybe we would realise that it was actually our boyfriends that we loved and end up breaking our own hearts. And this was all just really, really silly. Anyway, guys, it's been fun. I'll see you on the other side. I don't know why I said that.
Hi, it's Melissa. I'm going to be singing I Want to Dance with Somebody by Whitney Houston. So if you are in the house with somebody, grab them for a dance and a boogie. If you're on your Todd, dance on your Todd. But when this is all over, we're all going to go out and dance. Woo! Time. you wanna dance with me, boy? Don't you wanna dance? With somebody who loves. Don't you wanna dance? Say you wanna dance. Don't you wanna dance? Don't you wanna dance? Say you wanna dance. Don't you wanna dance? Don't you wanna dance? Say you wanna dance. You want to dance? This is Submission by Matt Gurr. When the coronavirus lockdown forces a dominant sex master and his submissive partner to attempt a virtual BDSM session, technical issues lead the two men to forge a different kind of connection. This was directed by Michelle Payne and Jack Raitman, and it's performed by John Skerritt and Joshua Wainwright. Enjoy.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me? I can't hear you. Is your mic on? Go on, click on settings, then audio. Then you need to click on internal mic to.
Has that worked?
Yes, that's worked. Sorry, my housemate's in, so can't be too loud.
Sorry.
No, don't apologize. Kind of goes against the vibe.
Oh, of course. Sorry. Not sorry. I hope he hears you and catches you. You dirty little...
Yeah.
Okay, how do you want to do this?
Don't know, I thought you'd lead.
Well, you know, this is kind of new to me.
How about you talk me through what you want to do to me and show me what you're going to do to me? And then, well, we take it from there.
Okay. I'll talk you through it and then show you. Got it?
Yeah, use your imagination.
Do we need a safe word?
I guess you're not really doing anything to me, so maybe we don't...
Yeah, of course, stupid.
No, let's have one anyway, in case you start saying too much or something.
Sure.
How about Matt Hancock?
What about him?
As a safe word, Matt Hancock.
Oh, I get it, yeah. Matt Hancock it is.
Should we get on with it then? See me, okay?
Yeah, fine.
Then let's go.
Okay. Turn around in your chair. Now. Show me your ass.
How's that, sir?
Shut up. Now, I'm gonna... You feel this?
Yeah.
Feel the leather against your skin? Rough against you?
Which one is it?
It's the new one. This. You can turn around to see which one I'm talking about.
Ah, gotcha. I like that one. Okay. Keep going.
Feel it? Up the inside of your thigh.
Oh, yes.
Up against your buttocks.
Yes, sir. Honestly.
And then... You've been a bad slave, haven't you? You disgust me. filthy pig.
I've been filthy.
How filthy have you been?
So dirty, I haven't been washing my hands. I just get on the tube, wash my hands for 20 seconds.
Stop, Matt Hancock.
Everything okay?
No corona talk, please. Let's just escape.
Oh, sure. Sorry,
It's okay. Let's get back to it. Yeah, just don't mention it.
Gotcha.
Bend over.
Yes, sir. Got the dildo now. The big one. Open your legs wider.
I'm gonna lube it up, and I'm gonna...
Gonna what? Oh, shit.
Dirty little. Would you like that?
Sorry, you froze there for a sec. I didn't get any of that.
What, not even the part?
None of it, I'm afraid.
Oh, it's quite hot.
Yeah. You froze.
I think it's my lodger. He's been furloughed, so he just stays in the flat watching Netflix all the time. Internet keeps lagging.
Can we keep this going? I was nearly getting into it then.
Yeah, maybe in a minute. I don't know, this just doesn't feel...
Yeah, it's not really working, is it?
I like being able to feel it, see it, taste it.
Yeah, me too. When this is all over, we'll have a proper good session, yeah?
I'd like that.
Do whatever you want to me.
Sounds great.
When this is over.
Whenever that is.
How are you holding up?
It's just hard, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like, it's only been a few weeks already, and I'm just not losing my mind, but it's hard. How about you? How are you doing with it?
Tough. I'm a doctor.
Oh.
Because you can imagine.
I didn't realize you were. What's it like?
He said, no corona talk. Matt Hancock.
Well, thank you. Thanks for everything you're doing.
In thanking for that dildo when this is over.
Missing things I didn't realize I valued so much. This, obviously, sex, touching. Hands in hands, thighs against thighs. Even simple things like making coffee for a friend or catching the bus. Oh, the cinema.
Oh, the cinema, yes. I missed that too. Being within 2 meters of someone.
I was pissed when James Bond was cancelled.
Yes, me too. So annoying. Big fan. Pre-bought my ticket and everything. You can always talk to me, you know? If you need.
I'll take you up on that. Fuck, I don't even know your name.
Thought you didn't do names.
Well, sometimes I do.
Well, all I'll say is that this is going to get a lot worse before it gets better. Keep your chin up, eh? After all this, the thighs, the coffee, the cinema, it'll all still be there. Trust me on this one.
Yes, sir.
So?
What?
I'll tell you mine if you tell me yours.
I'm Dom.
Fuck off! You're joking, Dom?
Yeah, Dom, Dominic.
Well, fucking hell.
And you?
Tony.
Nice to meet you, Tony.
Oh.
So how about it then? James Bond, after this is over, you and me?
Like a date?
If you like.
I would like.
Shit. Hour to my night shift.
Of course.
We could try this again if you like.
Yeah, sure.
Back who I was.
As you were. What next then?
You choose, sir.
Oh my god, what does this even mean? Oh my god, there's someone there, go!
You are so beautiful.
Let's listen to some music.
How did you know? I love this song.
Make our way downtown, walking fast, places past and the homebound. And I need you. And I miss you. And now I wonder if I could fall into the sky. Do you think I will pass me by? Well, you know I'd walk 1,000 miles if I can just see you tonight.
Mom? Dad? From home. Turn this water into rum.
Thank you.
Right, let's crack on.
Dear diary. Yes, I know you're actually a blog, but starting posts with the words Dear Diary makes me feel classy. And blog knows I don't get to feel like that very often. Do you think I could get the phrase blog knows to catch on? Nah, probably not. Sorry, that was a tangent and a half, wasn't it? I'll start over. Dear Diary, please remind me to never date an air sign again. Ever. If you could arrange for all the Aquariuses, Geminis and Libras to somehow disappear off the face of the earth, that'd be great. Not sure if that's within your capabilities though, being a blog, so I'll settle for a big red warning popping up on my iPhone every time an air sign tries to talk to me. It really would help. I'm not exaggerating here. The last 5 dates I've been on were all with air signs, and they were all disasters. First up, Tiffany. Name changed to protect the innocent. The innocent being me, not her. She was over an hour late to the pizza place we'd chosen because it was apparently close to her flat, so why was she so late? And she was dressed entirely in purple. Now, don't get me wrong, I have no issues with the colour purple, usually, and I probably wouldn't have noticed it was the only colour she had on if her opening line as soon as she sat down hadn't been, "I'm wearing all purple today. Even my thong is purple." Who leads with that on a first date? Obviously, I couldn't help myself. I immediately got a vivid picture in my head of her purple thong. It was weirdly sexy. We ended the dinner portion of the date right then and there and went back to hers for possibly the filthiest sex I've ever had. All night long. I'm joking. Clearly. Tiffany's thong didn't do anything for me. Especially not when I caught a glimpse of it later on in the evening. It looked withered. Like day-old red cabbage left out in the sun. Maybe we could have salvaged the day even after that, but for some reason she was one of those people who base their entire lives around their star sign. Libra, in her case. She's a lawyer. Does she wear purple to work, I wonder? Because Libras are all about balance, order, and justice. She has a cat and a dog in a London flat. How? And she gleefully shouted, "One of each! I couldn't choose!" straight after revealing this, startling our waiter so badly his fake Italian accent abandoned him and he never got it back. He was quite fit though. I might go back and see if he's single, but not if he's an air sign. You really don't need to know any of the million other things she told me about herself that night. Somehow managing not to ask me any questions in return, just a barrage of personal details and very loud chewing. I won't be requesting a second date. Well, maybe if the waiter is there. What can I say? Shallow is my middle name, which is a big improvement on my actual middle name. Thanks, Mum and Dad. Dates 2 and 3 have kind of blurred into one. There's a very good reason for that. The dates were at the exact same time. And in the same place. I don't want to go into it, in all honesty. Nowhere on my dating profile does it remotely suggest I am up for being double-teamed by a pair of elderly gentlemen in the back of a van. That was their idea, offered up right off the bat, and they didn't seem very open to compromising on this glorious, sordid vision. To add to this lovely bit of catfishing, they were both Geminis. In fact, they were twins. I literally couldn't stop shuddering for the next 24 hours. My fourth consecutive air sign date, maybe I should call them encounters instead, was with an Aquarius, Susie. This one definitely doesn't deserve to be referred to as a date. Susie was a diligent and rather creepy researcher who found out where I work, turned up mid-shift to surprise me, but approached the wrong person, and is now engaged to my hotter colleague, Ben. She moves fast, that Susie, as does Ben. It's a match made in heaven, or possibly the other place. Ben looks nothing like me, by the way, but he does look scarily similar to the fifth and final date in this saga, Fernando. Yes, I did have Can You Hear the Drums Fernando going round and round my head all day leading up to our date. Who doesn't love a bit of ABBA? Actually, quite a few people, mostly straight men, but shush, and I digress. By this time, I was starting to get wise to the trickery of air signs, so I breathed a sigh of relief when I saw Fernando was a Pisces. Pisces come with their own baggage, otherwise known as Pisces problems, of course, but at least he wasn't another air sign. He arrived perfectly on time and looked fantastic. Imagine the kind of guy you normally see on Abercrombie and Fitch bags. He was wearing a shirt, but my vivid imagination means he might as well not have bothered. Out of my league, but not threateningly so. I had a dream about you, he said, in a fairly thick Hispanic accent, which was something of a turn-on, once we'd sat down and been handed our menus. It wasn't the same restaurant I went to with Tiffany, don't worry, so no hot waiter. It's probably for the best. His hotness, combined with Fernando's, might have been too much for me to handle. A dream? I asked, doing a terrible impression of coy shyness and thinking, typical Pisces. Yeah, you are on your knees wearing a corset and you kept begging me to slap you with my... Whoa, hold on. This is not water sign behaviour. Well, maybe Scorpio behaviour. Thankfully, not that I am averse to wearing corsets in people's wet dreams. Go for it. Our waitress popped back just as he was about to finish his sentence and took our orders. Once she'd retreated out of earshot, he added, she was there too, in my dream, and her sister. I nearly choked on the complimentary tap water. Why are you telling me this? I managed to sputter. You're bi, came the answer. And if anything, this bit of the conversation and where I knew he was headed with it was making me more uncomfortable than the content of his dreams. So you came here for a threesome, right? Of course. Because that's all bisexuals want. We're not interested unless there are as many sweating bodies writhing around on top of each other as possible. What gave you that impression? I asked him, as calmly as I could. I have dated loads of bisexuals. Here we go. They always want an orgy sooner or later. Bit of a sweeping statement, I suggested. Not in my experience. Anyway, it's my birthday. Let's have a bit of fun, yeah? Alarm bells were ringing. The date that day was the 18th of February. This guy wasn't a Pisces at all. He was an Aquarius, another air sign. To avoid embarrassing myself by shouting, "You told me you were a Pisces, you liar!" or alternatively hitting him, whichever happened first, I told him I was going to the toilet, climbed out of the window like I was in a dodgy sitcom, and scarpered. Looking back, I could see him leaning very close to our waitress with his hand on the small of her back. So maybe he got his birthday threesome in the end after all, if she had a sister. But not with me. No more air signs. Ever. Until I find a really fit one, and then I'll probably change my mind. I'm such a typical Gemini that way.
This is 12 Pubs by Lauren Cooper. Small northern towns often have various weird traditions. Nobody knows quite where they come from or why, but they are deemed as a rite of passage. 12 Pubs explores the trials, tribulations, and hilarities of navigating the transition from teenage years to adulthood in a small northern town where everybody knows everybody. This is performed by Lauren Cooper. Enjoy.
It was the 12 Pubs last night. For anyone that isn't aware of my tiny Yorkshire town, it has very little to it. It has a castle and a river and 14 pubs squeezed into its cobbled streets. So naturally, some absolute genius in the 90s invented the 12 Pubs of Christmas. A sacred event that takes place every year and everyone goes. And I mean everyone. I was bumping into my dad's posty mate, so I have to act totally normal in front of ex-teachers. It is an event that even now, at the ripe old age of 23, I refuse to miss. My town also has another weird Christmas tradition on Christmas Eve, where prominent members of the town council dress up as creepy folk men, except for one who is wearing a black cloak with a horse's skull, and they walk around with tambourines pretending to beat the horse to death. We just sort of plod on with our hangovers and accept this weird display of animal cruelty, picking up our turkeys, and don't question it. Bit weird, really. My first 12 pubs, Q, Jess and me, armed with two pitchers from Spoons for £12 and a bottle of rosé. We made sure our laughter could be heard from the other side of the room. We spoke about what we wanted after college, shared fears about the fact we didn't know who we were yet. Normally, this fear of who I was would be enough to topple me. But with Jess, the person who I'd loved for my whole life, the greatest love I will ever feel, it felt reassuring. Like our words shared were small hugs and robing each other. We danced and ran through the marketplace hand in hand. Until the rosé pitcher mix bubbled inside me and I threw up in an ice bucket. Jess took me home and we disposed of the vomit-filled ice bucket in a recycling bin. only for Dad to find it on early Christmas Eve morning and have to spend the rest of the day cleaning out pink vomit from a bin. The ice bucket had upturned, spilling out the puke everywhere. He was not best chuffed. I mean, if anyone at this point would like the recipe to make their very own pink vomit, it is one Sex on the Beach from Spoons, preferably one that's sort of sunset-like in colour. One woo-woo, sparkly and purple, get that fizz going in the belly. And one bottle of rosé wine, preferably one that tastes like battery acid when it makes its way back up. New Year came, and I snuck out to a party. I'd been grounded after the ice bucket vomit incident. Luckily, being an only child meant I had my parents wrapped around my little finger. And after some convincing, they let me go, thinking it was a civilised dinner at a friend's house. It wasn't. It was a shot-filled Jaeger extravaganza where after four shots, because I'm a lightweight, I cried in a cupboard with a friend saying how everyone hated me. He thought everyone hated him too. Maybe being a teenager is just you thinking everyone hates you. We danced and we all hugged when the countdown started. It felt nice. And I realised it didn't matter. It truly didn't matter. The people around me right now, my parents, Jess, my mates, they all loved me for who I was. They loved me for the weird limbo person that I was, and they loved me even though I was still trying to figure out who me was. As I figured myself out, I started listening to indie music, wearing old lady jumpers from the charity shop, and even took up yoga. You know, the holy trinity of figuring yourself out. I got a boyfriend who lit candles and would play vinyls and sweep me up into his arms. The new boyfriend thing, though, now meant being grown up and choosing contraception. Luckily, I was a lot more versed in this than I was on the matter of my own anatomy or on my pubic hair, due to my auntie being a family planner. I knew there were countless options, it was just a matter of which one to go for, like a less fun lucky dip. Because if you choose wrong, instead of pulling out a toy dinosaur when you really wanted the slime, you'll get endless periods instead of stopping them. I opted for the implant first. My friend had been on it for years and I knew loads of people who had it. Unfortunately, as I learned the hard way, popularity isn't something you should choose your contraceptive choice off of. I got endless periods, and I mean endless. I would wake up in pools of blood that had run from my pad to my bedroom floor. So, the doctor, the lovely male, non-vagina owning doctor, decided to put me on the pill as well as the implant. For anyone that doesn't own a vagina or who has never been on any form of contraception before, let me tell you, being on two different forms pumping through your bloodstream at the same time is a ride. And not the good kind, the sort where you immediately know you're going to cry and vomit, and it was horrendous. At the time, I just thought it was the stress of A-levels or months of slut shaming or being 17. I stopped caring about anything. I stopped caring to a level where I didn't care if I was the one causing pain. I didn't care if I had a drama school to go to at the end of college. I didn't care that my parents were absolute angels. And honestly, I think the fact that Jess somehow managed to not punch me during the spiral of pharmaceutical-induced twattishness just proves that she defo deserves some sort of gold blue Peter badge for friendship. Actually, on that note, maybe it's not too late to still write to Matt Baker. I messed up a lot during that time. I took the advice of the wrong people and I left myself more heartbroken than when I found out Dan from Bastille was gay. That was a bad day. I wasn't me or any sort of version of me I ever want to revisit. Why was I told that contraception can cause migraines and weight gain, but not the impact it would have on my brain? Why wasn't I told that having double the estrogen levels was not the best idea? And why only at the age of 23, having had endless girly wine nights sharing stories, am I realising that this isn't just a me thing.
I've been set a task to write, and I'm not sure what to say. It seems lockdown has taken all my words away. I want to be a source of light when things seem dim. I want to give words of encouragement as loved ones fade away. I want to wipe your tears and hold on to all of your fears. But as I go to work and I see the chaos, and I come home to me, I sit and I wonder, what can I do? What can I say to help people in the darkest of their days? Really, all I want is to people to gain a little perspective on this life that is such a gift. I could regale people with the sights I see, but as a nurse, that's a job, not a hero. And sometimes, as a nurse, you don't feel entitled to feel the sorrow or accept the accolade. You're just there, trying to get through a shift, another door on another day. You see, I've been set this task to write, and I am not sure what to say. It seems locked down. Has taken all my words away. But all I want to ask is, what will you do? And if I have advice, maybe it's this. Take the time given. Because life, it is such a gift. Take the time given and make it count. Because I want to make it out this virus, and I want to stand among a crowd, and I want to feel alive. I want to tell the people I love, and that's you. After this virus, don't think, do.
Hello, it's Melissa. I'm going to be singing Cher Lloyd by Cher Lloyd. No, I'm singing Cher Believe. Should do a Cher Lloyd one, shouldn't I? With Becky G. When you're all dancing and singing along, doing your best Chers. I need love to feel strong. Baby, I'm too good for you. Oh, do you believe in life after love? I can feel something inside me say, I really don't think it's strong enough. No, do you believe in life after love? I can feel something inside me say, I really don't think it's strong enough. No, well, I know. I know that I am strong, and I don't need you anymore. No, I don't need you anymore. No, I don't need you anymore. No, I don't need you anymore. Do you believe in life after love? I can feel something inside. I really don't think you're strong enough, no. Do you believe in life after love? I can feel something inside me say, I really don't think you're strong enough, let's go. Do you believe in life after love? I can feel something inside me say, I really thank you. You can follow us on social media, on Instagram at MellyCavs, don't ask, Facebook on Melissa Kavanagh Music, and Twitter at Kavanagh Mel. All the varieties. But yes, thanks for having us, Tom. Mwah. And well done, everyone, on the submissions and things. But yeah, they were fab. Anyway, bye.